You're listening to All Things 3D, where we talk about the world of fabricating, designing, and capturing in the third dimension.
Morning, everybody.
Hey, good morning. Today we've got a special guest tuning in, huh?
We do. Hey, Josh, do we have your sound back? Nope. Let's see if we can bring him back from the dead. I muted him, and that was a bad thing.
There we go.
All right, am I back?
You're back.
Hey, guys, how's it going?
Okay, good. So where are you?
I'm at VRLA on the expo floor. It's about an hour and a half before the floor actually opens, but I'm sitting here in the Unity booth. Just getting to see the floor before it opens.
Wow. Yeah, it looks like it's quiet right now, but that probably won't be the case later on.
Yeah, I mean, they're expecting, I think, close today, probably about 500 or 600 people, maybe a little more. And then tomorrow, it's a kind of a full public event, and so probably over 1,000. At least that was last year's numbers. VRLA has been one of the fastest growing VR conferences. And every year, they've just grown by a couple hundred in size. And so this is pretty exciting. We got a keynote from the CEO of Unity today. I think Justin Roland from Rick and Morty, one of the creators of Rick and Morty, is actually doing the keynote tomorrow. And so we've got just tons of great presentations. The expo floor is huge. I'll walk you around a little bit to show off.
Yeah, please.
Obviously, we're here at Unity, and we got Intel, Unreal.
So are you on your front or your back camera right now?
I'm currently on my front, so I can actually see what's
going on. Yeah, why don't you go ahead and
zoom
around and let us be your eyes.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm going to apologize in advance. My to work out. So right now?
Oh, I can see you. It's a little
okay,
bit.
Okay, great. Yeah, so like I said, right here, I'm at the Unity booth. They're showing off, obviously, their famous physics engines, which I believe you're both a fan of, right?
Yeah, I do some work in it. Right now, I'm working in the Unreal engine, but Unity demo. What's kind of funny is that I did something called OR surgery for the iOS inside-out tracking system, and the surgeon in it is the same surgeon that's firing a sniper rifle in the police force in that video that they were playing. So look out for that.
That's hilarious.
Kind of a little trivia, which is one of the great things about Unity, is that they have so much content. So, you know, if you're a novice or you just don't have the time or the budget to create all your own content, there's plenty of it there. What's that there?
It's because I'm excited about it. So this is a company called Star VR, and I believe they're going for cinematic VR experiences that are actually going to be installed in theaters. But they have a headset with 210 field of view and 5K resolution.
You just went to portrait.
Sorry, guys, we're on mobile, and there is little technical difficulties.
No, that's fine. We're prepared. Chris and I have gone through this several times.
Star VR, we covered last week. We covered IMAX, is doing some installations. I wonder if they're trying to win over that market.
Yeah, I'm excited. I haven't, so the expo floor is not actually open yet. Oh, what's going on here?
No problem.
Can you hear me?
I can still hear you, but yeah.
All right, well, as long as you can hear me, that's progress. Sorry, guys. Let's see if I can get this
no
going.
No apologies. We know that this happens. The fact is that we've got some video already. It's cool.
My Sim Note 5, to show its age a little bit. I think I'm going to have to go portrait mode. Can you see me?
That's fine.
Okay. Yeah, my gyroscope is not cooperating. This is called Mind Show, and this is actually from VRLA. And this is a really cool app. I've actually been able to do the alpha of it. And basically what it is you get to create a film. And how it works is you pick a character, you set up the stage, you set up the props, and then once you get into your character, you actually embody the character. So you go into a first-person view of the character, and you act out a scene. And as you act out a scene, it records. And then when you stop, you can pick another character, put them in the scene, and then you can go into that person's first point of view. And so what you can do is you can go back and forth and kind of do like an improv session with yourself and record some pretty hilarious videos. I was actually hanging out with Kent By, a Voices of VR.
Yeah,
and,
great podcast.
Yeah, so what we would do is we would take turns. I would go in and record for a bit, then he would go in and record for a bit off of what I had recorded, and then his partner would go in. And by the end, we would just have this like total nonsense, hilarious, kind of goofy thing.
Wow, that sounds awesome.
Yeah, so I would definitely check that out, Mind Show. Yeah, I'm trying to see what else to show you. Like I said, the expo floor is not actually open yet. So obviously, things
what
are still being put
thing?
Together.
Yeah, what's
this
that going
thing on? Is a puffer fish 360 globe. So what it does is it actually has a projector inside.
It's
designed for being able to do footage.
You're blowing my mind right now.
It's There's the
some
puffer
pretty cool,
fish.
Pretty just, cool tech here.
We're just starting on the third season. Grim, and there's a puffer
and I
fish
believe
guy
so well this is neat, guys. This is actually touch sensitive.
Wow, so you can spin it.
So I'm using my finger to spin. It's pretty entertaining.
That's kind of fun.
Wow,
technology's
awesome.
Getting fun, guys. There's a lot of really cool stuff here. Theta is here with their camera. I also saw, what's that new 360 camera you're really interested in, Michael? Is it the Views?
No, it's a Samsung. Well, there's the Views that, I've been anxious to get a hold of for some time. They've been very quiet and not responding to me. You can get in there and find out the exact date that they're actually going to be taking deliveries.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to. I'm walking towards them right now. I'm walking slow so I can try to keep this camera as stable as possible. But yeah, they're here. And I actually saw one of their cameras last night at the Upload VR launch party. I don't know if everyone knows, but Upload VR is a kind of like a press, VR-related press, but they've also got into the co-working and incubation space, and so they just opened a brand new office here in LA, which was really cool. They've got this huge co-working space, tons of VR units, and some really great VR companies.
That's super cool. So the other 360 camera that I'd like you to look at later on is the Samsung Gear 360. They've got their version 2 coming out that now has a handle attached to it. Unknown the pricing. Maybe you can figure that out, but it's supposedly less than $300. That's what the previous version retailed for when it first came out.
Keep in mind, that'll be impressive.
You can get the previous version of that camera for about $200 now. So I'm thinking it's maybe $250, between $300. The Views that we just mentioned, that's a super cool camera. They've just pushed the date again to May, so maybe you can get a better firm date on that one.
I'll definitely report back on that. This looks like the Vive station. So it's HTC likes to show up and show off all of their awesome content that they've been helping to curate.
So that'll be cool there if you come back to it. That little green setup that they have there. What they do with that is they actually, that's an actual harness. They can take that camera, which has one of the trackers on it, and they actually track the camera. And next week, I'm going to do a how-to in my last, it's part of my VR home remodeling, where I'm actually going to be in my home. And you can see me being in my home. It probably won't be as fancy as what you're seeing there. But essentially, by tracking, it'll give you, or the audience, the ability to see what you're doing while you're in VR. And,
so some people call it mixed reality, and it's definitely really exciting. It's pretty entertaining.
I've tried to stay away from that because mixed reality, at least from my camp, is when you're mixing reality and augmented reality. VR and create objects.
There's lots of arguments about just that in the industry.
Yeah. Well, I just don't. Just for the confusion's sake, but this is cool too because it allows you to mix video. Let's call it mixed video. Where you can track while you're in VR. So hopefully I can do a tutorial next week on that in my last section, my third of four parts of the VR home.
I'm going to see if my phone will play nice. Oh, look at that. We're working again. Yeah, so I don't know if this continues to interest you guys, but I can continue to walk around and show you a little bit.
I'm interested.
Yeah.
Great.
So here's
the views booth.
Next year, we just need you to take the views and be able to upload in VR so we can actually be there.
Exactly.
Well, sadly, the views does not do real time. Remember, we talked about it in the interview. It is a close to 4K stereo, which is the important thing. And for its price, which is about $800, it's great, but it is not real time. Instant 360, which I've talked about before, is having a version that I would play with that works with the iPhone or iOS devices. This is what I'll show off on Monday in our meetup. And then also, the GearView 360 will also do live 360, both on Facebook as well as YouTube.
That's impressive. You know, I just met this company called VertiSync. Don't quote me on that, but they're working on, or they have, a service where they say they can host up to 8 and even 12K footage and stream it to 360. So apparently they've created a software that enables that level of bandwidth, or that compression algorithm to work. So there's definitely some interesting technology coming forth for being able to stream higher and higher resolutions. And I think we'll see some exciting developments in the Live 360 this year as well.
I sure hope so. I mean, Live 360 is nice, but because of bandwidth limitations, you're either limited to at max 2560, but pushing 4K is really an issue right now. And one of the suggestions I've had is download it using a couple of free apps and then view it offline, which really works well.
Yeah, it does.
Obviously,
absolutely.
The presence of live, like, imagine, Chris, right now, instead of him just giving us that view, he has this on his head with a cap or something. I don't know. I'll fix him up something the next time he heads up, and with a bike helmet or something. But that way, you can look at whatever you want. You know, he doesn't have.
Yeah,
to
that would be entertaining.
Hey, what are you looking at? One of the three of us will have to don that.
I'm already laughing at the image of myself in a bike helmet walking around an expo floor with a camera attached to my head.
Hey, you know, everybody will come up to you. You have not seen my setup in the past when I've come, but it was pretty. I had a 10-inch Windows tablet. It had like three cameras, including the V360, which was one of the first 360s. And remember, Chris, everybody just kept coming, what is that thing? I said, it's a secret confidential unit, and you're now being recorded for the CIA.
So there's, I bet they love that. So there's two cool things here. We have the visual reality visionary art zone. So a good friend of mine, Zachariah, has created this gorgeous visionary art piece called Galactic Gallery. And he's actually launching the newest version of that this weekend here. So excited about that. And then we have, I don't know what Odyssey VR
is. Is that like a simulator?
It does. It looks like a roller coaster simulator or some kind of VR-based ride in a booth. I think this is going to be really big, and we're going to start to see more and more, you know, VR-based arcades popping up.
Yep, I agree.
And yeah, like this one that looks like they're doing like a high-speed helicopter racing or something in the simulator. I'm definitely going to have to come back and try this.
Well, you know, as we mentioned, I'm ready to come back at 1 or 2 if you want to come back on, or just, you know, record some footage on your phone and upload it, and then I'll put together something and it'll be
great. Yeah, I'll either record, I'll definitely minimum record, but I'll see if I can't come back on live around 1 as well. I'm going to catch the keynote from the CEO of Unity. But yeah, definitely would love to come back and at least get some footage for you guys to see from the floor. You know, if anyone is in LA or near LA, tickets are still available. Today's the professional ticket, so it's $300. But tomorrow is the more kind of open to the public, and I believe the ticket's only $50. if anybody wants, you can actually use the coupon VRLA_PDX, as in Portland, PDX, in all caps, and that gets you 15% off a ticket. I definitely think it's worth coming out. It's going until about 8 tonight, from my understanding. And it's going to be a lot of fun to see some of the latest content. There's a lot of 360 film here, a lot of technology for cameras. I can actually walk over and show you some of the higher ends on the spectrum of 360 cameras. But there's a lot to see here. It's really a great event.
Yeah, I would imagine that a lot of LA, you know, being that, you know, a lot of content creators are in LA, you know, being that Hollywood and that whole, I would imagine that a lot of the movers and shakers are going to be attending this show just to keep, you know, kind of keep tabs on what's going on and moving into the space, because I think a lot of those content creators are going to be moving into this space.
Exactly. Yeah. Last year, there was just so much 360 content. I got to try some really unique experiences. You know, it's still really early in film in VR. And so people are just kind of getting out there, making mistakes, moving forward, trying things. And I think we're going to see a lot more of that this year. In fact, last year, one of my favorite pieces was actually done in stop motion. They used a 360 camera and models, took a shot, moved the models, took a shot. You know, just that traditional way of making
stop motion,
and it was so good. Wow. It was the highest quality 360 video I'd ever seen, because the cameras are great, right? And so they were able to make this really high resolution experience.
There was a video that came out with the Oculus that was, it's on there, and I can't remember if it's like, it's kind of filmed in the same style as another movie called Coraline, I'm remembering it, and it's like, it's kind of a similar style, but I remember watching it. It was one of the freebies that kind of came with the Oculus when it first came out, and it was kind of stop motion-esque. I don't know if it was the same, you know, actually filmed stop motion, or if it was computer animated.
Totally.
But yeah, wow, look at this set back here.
Yeah, so I wanted to just point this out. This is the Visbit that I was actually telling you about. So they are 360 VR streaming, and I was talking with one of their engineers last night, and they said they can stream up to 12K at this point. So very, very interesting technology for anybody that's looking to be able to distribute their kind of higher resolution experiences. What they were saying is they actually have an API that can plug in directly to your app. So you can have your own custom built app and be able to stream this much higher resolution video than, say, Vimeo or YouTube. So worth checking out for the 360 content creators. This is a fun thing they're doing this year, because as most people know, Sunday is actually Easter. So what they're doing is they're teamed up with HoloLens and Microsoft, and they've created a HoloLens Easter egg hunt.
What?
Yes.
Can you move in a little bit closer?
Yeah, absolutely.
Are you going to get to play with the HoloLens before me, Josh?
You haven't played with the HoloLens yet?
Oh, God. No, I've been wanting to.
Oh, man, you got to catch up. Yeah, I've gotten to use the HoloLens a couple times.
I'm a little spoiled.
I live in Portland, and there's a company called Oregon Storyboard that was one of the first organizations to actually get access to the HoloLens.
Okay.
And they got a grants through the Oregon State University. Don't quote me on that, but basically they've got a grant through a university in conjunction with Microsoft, and they got early access. And so they have a whole fleet of HoloLenses, and they've been developing some really cool stuff. And so a friend of mine is a very high-end 3D modeler who works in Unreal, and he had created this gorgeous Tron motorcycle.
Whoa.
And, of course, he was hanging out at Oregon Storyboard, and so the people were like, well, let's get this in the HoloLens. And so I got to interact with a Tron motorcycle in the HoloLens.
Oh, wow. That's too fun.
That was a trip. That was a lot of fun. So this is going to be pretty cool. I know, right? Yeah, wow. I'm imagining that these little balls are used for tracking. And they've kind of blended it in. As you can see, like the bush has all these. I'll get a little closer.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm seeing these all over the set, and I'm imagining that's for actually tracking. And so this is going to be a lot of fun. You get to go in there, use the HoloLens, and find some Easter eggs.
Wow.
keep in mind, and I think personally, the Microsoft HoloLens tracking system is superb. You don't necessarily need trackers, and they perform real-time, what they call mesh analysis, so that those are...
Okay.
It's a similar technique to the inside-out tracking that the Occipital works with. What's interesting is, as you're probably aware of, Microsoft, and I'm hoping that you get a chance to see one, is coming out with... in fact, it was just released this Tuesday, the Creative edition of Windows 10, which includes the mixed reality portal. And,
interesting.
Very soon, people will be able to get the Acer developer. I'm hoping, crossing my fingers, that I'm one of them. And also, by the end of the year, there will be other mixed reality headsets from $300 to $500 that will allow you to do inside-out positional tracking, 6 degrees of freedom, so you can move around in space without having the HTC trackers, which will be really cool. And
yeah, that sounds great. Microsoft really does seem to be going hard on this technology, which is fantastic.
Yeah, I really think so. And one of the things to keep in mind on the Microsoft mixed reality system is one of the things that identifies is for you to scan your...
Hold on, Mike. I'm going to interrupt real quick. We've got a local Portland celebrity down here in LA. This is Kent Bai.
You got in.
Hi, yeah, I got in. We're live on the air right now for All Things 3D.
Oh, okay. Hi, yeah. All Things 3D.
Yeah. Hi, Kent. I don't know how are you?
They said hi as well.
Okay.
I just wanted to say hi. I'm just showing them the expo floor.
Okay.
Maybe I shouldn't say, but both Kent and I snuck in to the expo floor.
Yeah, we're not supposed to be here.
We're not supposed to be here.
We're radical journalists.
Yes.
That's the only way to be.
Trying to tell the story of what's happening here.
Exactly. Exactly.
And I'm a big fan of yours. I listen to your podcast regularly. I mentioned that to him.
Michael is a very big fan of yours.
Okay.
He listens to your podcast regularly.
Great.
I feel awkward Michael. Doing the in between, but
yeah.
Michael. So maybe sometime.
If he's going to be at the meeting, come visit the
All Things 3D.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds good. Yeah.
All right, Ken.
All right. Enjoy the tour.
Yeah. Good to see you. Yep. We'll see you soon.
Now he actually does it. For those of you who aren't familiar watching the show, he does a great podcast where he does a lot of interviews with the people that develop in VR. He's just started, I think, in the last 6 months doing initial analysis before he starts it, which is kind of fun because we get to listen to a different perspective. But what he's known for is doing great interviews with the content creators and developers in VR.
Yeah, so Kent has, at this point, close to 550 published podcasts. I know for a fact he has about 200 or 300 unpublished because he's just a monster when it comes to the interviews. He goes to these events, he hits the floor, he has no schedule, and he just lets kind of the natural rhythm reveal itself, and he just ends up meeting and sitting with and interviewing some of the most major players in the VR industry. So if any of your viewers are like, man, I need a crash course in VR, voicesofvr.com is the way to go. His library is amazing. And he's actually writing a book right now as well called The Ultimate Potential of VR. And
Well, tell Ken if he ever wants to come on our show, we'd love to have him.
Absolutely. Yeah, I did
talk about
that. We were talking about you. He remembers getting an email from you. and he gets a lot of emails is what he says.
Well, if he can ever, find the time, or like you said, if he's still in Portland. Do you know if he'll be at the meetup this Monday?
Potentially, yeah. He might swing by. Haven't confirmed yet, but he might swing by.
Well, I won't.
Whoa,
see
look at this bright thing in the background.
Which one?
Over to the right. Well, yeah.
Yeah. So it's like a giant projector, and it's actually, if you look on the walls, you see all the lights being projected.
Yeah.
You can't see them too great on the camera.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing that's doing
that.
Cool. Yeah, yeah, and so it's actually projecting like VRLA logos and some other logos. It's pretty cool. They do their best to this is virtual augmented mixed reality, so they do their best to actually, walk the talk. So I wanted to show you guys this. This is Radiant Images. Radiant Images has done some really cool things. They're making very high-end 360 cameras. So they, obviously they've got the Ozo they helped develop, the Jaunt 1. Now these are definitely not your consumer
That
grade
looks like
cameras.
A great booth.
Yeah. Especially for, again, we're in LA, so this is all about the 360 and the film is very popular. Mm-hmm. But this is all custom. I think this thing has 27 cameras on it. It's ridiculous. It's so many cameras. And then they've got this really practical looking guy.
I'll see, you won't feel so bad just being on it with a bike helmet, will you?
I know, yeah, a bike helmet looks like...
I can see Mike wearing that.
Like the easy
way.
I
would wear it in a minute.
I know you would wear it. I've seen you wear stuff like that.
Yeah, so they're releasing new cameras all the time. I actually have a friend who works in the 360 film, and he said he got to go visit them in their offices, and that they have some tech that they haven't even released publicly yet, but like $1 million camera. He said that used something like, oh gosh, I think it was like upwards of 30 professional, like high quality RED cameras. Yeah, so they're doing some crazy stuff to try to get to cinema level broadcasting 360 films.
So Josh, you've exceeded our online at this
very
particular point.
Very
We've got
gracious.
8 viewers, so man, you're drawing them in.
Great. How many viewers do we got?
Eight viewers right now.
8 viewers.
Yeah.
Wow, this is a big broadcast. Well, hello That's to the 8 viewers.
Yeah. Well, very gracious to you, Josh. Thank you for sharing the show floor with us.
Absolutely. Yeah, thanks for the opportunity to share. And I'll report back everything that I discover.
Yep. Well, really appreciate it, Josh. This has been really fun. And we'll see you a little bit.
All right. That sounds good, guys.
Bye, Josh. Thank
Take
you.
Care. Yeah, farewell.
Well, that sure was fun.
Yes, it was.
Awesome. Man,
it's going to make the rest of the show kind of a downer now. That was really
No. We got plenty to cover.
Yep. And on that note, let's go ahead and get started with our opening video then. So let me go ahead and cue it up.
Cue it up, Mike.
Cue it up. All right. So I'm going to jump to my camera and then I'll cue it up. But
my name is Kenneth Moore. I'm 38 years old.
He just mentioned the ability to
20 years in
VR. I'm sorry.
My integration back in society hasn't been easy.
Can you hear it?
Fine.
Yeah.
But I'm not.
I'll turn it down a little bit. Can you hear me as well?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. So essentially, this is a 360 on Facebook that talks. It's an interview with a guy, and this uses two different techniques. It uses volumetric recording, which is, if you notice, he's kind of glittering a little bit, shifting. That's because it's a 3D kind of hologram type thing. It's uses multiple cameras to create a 360 3D image of him, and then superimposes it in a photogrammetry created 3D cell, which you see there. And if you notice, I can actually move around in the cell. But obviously, if you're wearing this as a headset, this would give you the
noises, the banging,
the experience of being in a solitary cell while he's talking about, the stuff that he went through. You notice how they put text on the walls. So I'm going to continue. This is actually done by a company that we'll get to in a moment that does these kind of things. It was presented on Frontline, but as mentioned, this was done through Facebook.
Or anything that's in the cell that's useful to make a fishing line. Literally, they're fishing lines because that's what you do. You fish. You tie. Get some paper, make a string. We do this to pass desserts, kites, which are another word for letters, magazines, newspapers, anything basically that you want to get from one cell to another because there is absolutely no human contact.
So awful.
And then we take it and we fling it out the door and it'll go in another cell.
Now, it's difficult to hear, but they also used positional sounds. So as he moves around, you can track him. And I think that's extremely important, as we talked about before, of identifying where you're at. So there you go. That's pretty cool, I think. And obviously, one of the great ways to show new narrative and actually provide the experience, and we're probably going to see much more of that soon. So I'm going to bring this up here. This is the actual, and all these links will be in our show notes. But this is Frontline After Solitary. It talks with this gentleman, so you're welcome to go out there. But one thing I wanted to show that I thought was kind of cool, let me stop this. Let's see if I can find it. Here is the actual footage. Now, this is a lower quality footage from...
My name is Kenneth Moore.
Facebook. Now, notice what Facebook, this is a cube map. Unlike YouTube, which uses equirectangular...
My integration back to society hasn't been easy.
They use spherical to cube mapping. And the advantages of doing so is that you get better, what do you want to call it, edge resolution as you get further away. It has a clearer capability. Okay.
When I walked into my cell in the mid-90s.
Hang on a second. Okay, how's that?
Yeah, that's better.
Yeah, I've got like a dozen different volume controls and I have to scroll up and down. Okay, so this, as you can see, is the same video, but it's the full six elements, actually six, of the cube map itself, each face. And then this is projected so that back into a spherical. And the advantage of it is it provides better edge definition. It's kind of hard to describe. More detail that you normally can't see because you're going from a polar to equirectangular versus a cube map. And you just get clearer edges and less artifacts around those the bending that normally occurs. And so it's interesting to see, and I had not seen this until now, that Facebook, I have read about it, does the cube mapping. And as mentioned, YouTube uses equirectangular. And then if you remember last week, we talked about a new technique that Google YouTube is using that takes advantage of some new capabilities with equirectangular by providing more detail in areas that are lost normally in equirectangular. So obviously both of them are working towards it. Now, what I have not seen, and I don't know if it exists, Facebook does not provide stereo 360. This is just a single, what do you want to call it, monoscopic 360, which loses that depth information that you now can see on YouTube if you're running a stereo 360 image. Now, I don't know that for a fact, but I have not really seen any contact that does 360. Stereo. But I thought that would be kind of neat to kind of show that off. So back to the website. So you can check this out yourself on Frontline. As mentioned, the company is emblematic. And the reason I'm bringing this up is that there was an interview done in Forbes magazine with what they're considering the godmother of VR. And she pretty much started creating these type of, sorry if you're hearing all this. Oops, jeez. Everything has ads in it nowadays. But she talks about how she had her start back in 2012, creating, I want to call it Across the Line, which was like a 3D, models that allowed you to pan around. It's funny is that she did this in Berkeley and they wouldn't let her take the VR headset. So she met up with, it's kind of a fun story at the end, with Palmer Luckey, who had just come out with his prototype back then. And she was able to take that and actually use that to Sundance. So I thought that's kind of, so this is back in 2012. So she's been doing this. If you haven't heard of Project Syria, that was somewhat popular. I think it was one of those video services. So if you haven't seen it, that's a good one to look at. It actually puts you in Syria in the one of the camps, if I remember correctly. So you actually have a good feeling of it. A lot of people didn't like it because it was too close to home or made you have that experience that you may or may not want. But I think this is where this stuff really works, and she obviously is at the forefront of doing it. So check out the article and also go back and look at the in solitary or after solitary to get a better experience with it, with your headset, not just the way we showed it here. So that is about it. I want to move right into the Bevel 3D. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'll jump back to my main camera and bring it up. So, you know, Chris, we talked about it last week. Matter and Form has brought out a camera system, 3D camera, that plugs into your headset.
Yeah, I've got one here. I haven't used it yet, but it's here.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the reasons you said you're not using it is because you don't really have a phone you think will be adequate. Try it. I don't know. However, as I mentioned before or emailed to you, you don't necessarily have to have an iPhone. I would have been using this with my little iPod Touch 6G, and you could probably use it with an iPad. Obviously, it'll give you a big iPhone type app, but you still can use it. And the reason for that, and I'll go ahead and show it now, this is on the iPod Touch. It has a little standard, you know, phone
TRS.
Jack. Yes. Yeah, 1/8 jack. And you plug it into the earbud. And this works probably very similar to how you obtain information from like the Square card reader. And so you plug it in. And if you notice, there's a little back plate, and this one isn't made for this, but they have two others with different spacing so that it fits better depending on the size of your device. So I haven't changed it and really haven't needed to do it, because essentially what you want to do is make sure that you don't move it and it's parallel with the back of your device here. But there are two others, so it provides some flexibility. The other thing it comes with is this little calibration device, and this is what I think might be the holdup for this product, but we'll see. So there you go. And I've already calibrated, so I'm going to go ahead and give a demo. What do you think?
Yeah, let's check it out. I want to see how it does. Mine's still in the box. It came day before yesterday, so I just haven't had the time to pull it out. Yeah. And I think we got the early birds. I think we got them for like 50 or 60 bucks or something like that. And I think now they're retailing for what, 89 bucks?
I think 80, 79 if I remember, or 80.
Which is a good price for an experimental thing. And, you know, it was a year and a half late, but, you know, that's not unheard of on Kickstarter.
But at least they're shipping. So yeah. Give them hats off. I mean, unlike another company, Sixth Sense, who still has not come anywhere close to this. In fact, it's funny, something else I back that provides positional tracking for Android and devices is already showing off their injection plastic mold housings. So it's like, that's a long story. We don't need to bring that. So yes, $89. So you're correct. Near 90. If you can see behind me here. So let's go back to the main.
And I don't want to give a review or my take because I have no idea.
Well, I do, and I will provide some feedback. I like their little promo video too. So we'll.
This is Charlene. This is Charlene's Bevel. This is Captain Pugsley. Charlene Pugsley likes to capture him in 3D. Captain Pugsley. Be like Charlene. Share your fur baby in 3D with Bevel.
Captain Pugsley.
Anything with a weird cat has got to be cool. So.
I think that's really what this is. This product really is, and why it really got me really quick was the idea of 3D scanning my dog very quickly. You know, not trying to have using photogrammetry where he has to sit still for an extended period of time, or trying to use some plugged-in scanner and try to go around him. I just wanted a quick and dirty. Basically like a relief of him, you know what I mean? Like a relief of his face.
Well, speaking of that, obviously that's
because we adore our animals, right?
Well, I actually did that. That's one of the things that I posted last
week. Of
course,
that's why everybody, that's why they're going after it with the, obviously with the marketing, is that's what everybody's buying this for, is to scan their cat or their dog. Every single person that signed up for this, I guarantee owns, has a pet that they bought this because they want to scan their pet.
Okay, well, let me find my camera here. There we go. And set up this so that
this is Pugsley character. That's a funny cat. That's a funny cat.
So, here we go. Yeah. All right. So here's your screen.
I love the one of you on the top right.
But as I said, I scanned some of my animals. So let's take a look at that. So what you get, you have like a gallery, so you can save them or delete them. But here we go. So my little furry assistant Ridley is, you know, kind of hanging out there. He's always really good. I said, okay, act like you're sleeping, and he did. But, you know, I didn't put a lot of effort into it. Notice the gap, because remember, this is basically shining a laser and recording the images back to your phone. So it's line of sight. So that for you to see anything on the other side, you have to physically move. And I haven't, I sent out a question on this, but I haven't heard back from them if this does stitching as well you track. Now, remember, I've shown a number of times the structure sensor with the ASUS 3D app, as well as my own app, where it literally will stitch in real time as you track around an object. I don't think that's the case with this. The other thing that I noticed is if you go back to, and see if I can see what kind of options I have. I may not.
So the scans are not great.
Well, it depends on how much effort you want to put in. But the points I'm wanting to make is that they're actually okay. I did notice that they don't have the high resolution mode, and I don't know if it's because I'm using an iPod. I didn't get any feedback on that.
I've been reading this morning. There's actually a pretty good thread at the top of the 3D scanning subreddit right now, and it's all about the bevel. Everybody's saying, okay, we got our bevel, but there's a lot of the features that they touted are not there. Okay. So I don't know.
So it appears to be true, and as mentioned, they didn't respond back to me.
They're probably so busy just shipping the rest of the Kickstarter units out.
Or silencing the fires. I don't know. Okay, yeah, so let's go ahead and play with this a little bit. So as you can see me with my screen behind me. So I'm going to go ahead and take a new photo. Okay, there we go. And it says, please connect your bevel. So I'll unplug it and plug it back in. So it's interesting that I lost my AirPlay, so I don't know if I'll be able to do this.
There we go.
Okay, so good. All right, so there you go. So the idea is to put your face in it like that.
Okay.
And then if you look at the bottom there, you can use your front or your back camera. Obviously, the front camera is not going to have the same resolution as your back camera. I did Ridley with the back camera, and all you have to do is turn your little unit around, just unplug it and plug it back in the other way, and then you can use your back camera. And then you see right here, it says maybe too bright. You can actually block and change it. So notice So it went away. And now I can just push up. And the laser should
Yikes! That's making a weird noise. Uh-oh. Sorry, Mike, I had to mute you. It was going crazy there with your sound. I muted you. Sorry, now I can't unmute you.
Okay, now you can hear me?
Yeah, now I can hear you. It was making some weird sound.
Well, it might be the interface in this that the mic was picking up. Actually, it makes sense because it might be using an audio transmission technique. Oh, well, but the problem is it didn't activate the laser, so you may have to mute me again. Let's see what happens.
Can't mute you. I can't mute you. Oh, no.
That's okay. There we go. All right,
yeah.
So the pitch went away. All right,
I don't think we could do it.
Well, we just probably won't be able to see it. So I'll go ahead and do this.
So it's obviously sending the audio over the, it's obviously an audio signal because it's going through that audio jack.
That's what I'm assuming.
Yeah, yeah.
And that makes sense. We're actually hearing that high-pitched sound probably is the tone.
It's not high-pitched.
Remember the old modem?
It's like making a really like a loud racket. It's terrible.
Okay, so I'm turning off the AirPlay. So let's see if I can go back now and.
And now Mike's frozen. What did you do, Mike? Come back to us. Well, he's in the middle of showing us this Bevel 3D. And so I guess we'll just wait for him to come back in because he's going to come back in. And yeah, so I think trying to do it over the AirPlay and have the little and do a scan at the same time is probably. Are you back, Mike? Okay, I don't think that's going to work.
No, it wasn't this. I just also had simultaneously the authentication from Google, which says every 30 days, but it seems like it's less of it. So it's like one thing or another. Okay, so here
Windows
we go.
Windows 10 needs to update. Hold on. Hold on. I got to be right back. I have that Windows update this week, like all the Windows computers. It's like even if you turn off the automatic update, it seems like it automatically does
it. Yeah, we can talk about that. Okay, so here we go. You ready? All right, so hopefully it'll work now. So you should see, there we go, a laser on my face.
I do. I see a laser on your face. Okay. That can't be good for you.
Actually, it's a class one, and they say it's not a problem. Just don't do it.
Just don't look at it.
Yeah, just don't look at it.
That seems like a terrible idea.
It's not.
It's only a class one, bro.
Huh? Here we go.
Only a class laser. Class one laser.
All right, here we go. You ready?
Yeah, we're ready.
All right.
Keep going. Keep going.
All right. So now it takes a few seconds. So I can jump back to that screen now while it's doing that. All right, so here we go. So this actually takes a little bit of time. So I'll just put it down here.
That actually looks like it did a pretty decent job on that one.
Well, actually, that's just an image. We'll see.
Oh, got it.
It does take some practice. And the other thing I want to point out, as we talked about, this little calibration block is... should I say non-intuitive? If you're a technician, you probably won't have any issue with it. But essentially, the idea is to identify the optics of your device. So essentially, you move your camera around and match the pattern to the lens on your device, which is one of the reasons you require it, because you don't know what type of device is being used. You don't know the optics. And even between optics in the same unit, you may have some small variations. So this is required, and essentially you just match the template with the one that's on your screen, and then it asks you to rotate it a little bit. And so it takes a little bit of time, and I'm just concerned that this might frustrate some people. But if you spend 5 or 10 minutes, it's pretty good. So you do this, and then you have to do it with the laser running. And that actually I found pretty easy. Essentially, you get the laser line in the black space. So you pretty much put this on a table, and then you put the scanner on your phone above it, and then just follow the instructions. It does a good job in providing step-by-step instructions. It's interactive, so as you move from one calibration point to the other, it tells you what to do and has a little visual. And if you're not positioning it correctly, it tells you a little bit of how to correct it. If you're a gamer, you'd probably do this really quick. Who knows? But I found that this might frustrate a few people. But once it's calibrated, you don't need to do it anymore, which could be a concern because, as mentioned, I didn't put on the proper spacer on the back of it or backing. So it may not be properly in place, and there might be a little bit of variation, which might be a reason for some of these scans not coming out right. So make sure that you have the proper backer. Again, to remind you, this little piece here.
It looks like a satellite phone with that thing on there.
Hello! Speaking from China. Okay. But what is fun about this, this is literally a laser scanner and you are the positioner. So remember those laser scanners we had before a long time ago, back in 2013 that I built you that we never really got working? Essentially, that was a line laser with a webcam, and you essentially rotated your object and recorded images, and then you compiled those images together to create your 3D object. So essentially, it took that line deformation to determine the 3D information of your device.
The cross-section, yep.
Yep. And so you just put a bunch of those slices. Well, this is doing the same thing, except you're that little positioner. So I'm thinking if you put this on like a tripod mount. Oh, are we ready? Let's see what happens. Dun, da, da. Dun, da, da.
Oh, man, that's not good. Okay. Well.
Okay, but here's one that I did before the show.
And that's not great, is it?
But one of the things they do identify, what's behind me?
Green.
A green screen. They do say have a background that has variety. Obviously, a solid green.
Well, there you go. If they tell you that, then come on. I mean, if they're telling us that, then that's what we got to do.
Right. So what I should do, give them credit. So I'm going to cancel this Apple TV. I'll turn this way. Okay, so let me turn this off. Okay, here we go. Can you see me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So let me go back to... Okay. All right, here we go. Well, that's not going to work good. All right, stop. All right, here we go. Well,
little hard with one person. I think it's better to have maybe like.
Well, I don't have
for you. You know.
I think that's mainly my problem. I'm in a tight, confined area, so I don't have a lot of room, and I'm trying to position it. But the whole point is, if you have a good background behind you, like I did, the little doggy worked pretty good. So let me jump back to the screen.
It worked okay. Right.
Well,
but maybe next week you'll have a few dozen more scans under your belt and you'll be able to show us.
Well, let me look. Let's see if they bring up the, there's a website they have.
The Cashew thing, right? I think it was Cashew.io or something like that. I remember they launched something.
So let me find that. And then here are some examples from 2016. Okay, so I'm going to log in and then you can see some of the ones that I did earlier. Okay, so Okay, I think I'm here now. All right, so I'm gonna log in. Okay. Let's look at, okay, so here's my favorite, my little scan. This is my skull that I've scanned on several occasions.
So again, it's kind of more of like a relief. It's not so much like a 360 scan. You kind of, you know, you could get somebody's face, so you could put somebody's face onto maybe a model that you already had. So, you know.
Well, the key, yeah, how do I describe it? The main point behind this device is that it uses the laser line scanner and your camera in your phone in order to record it. Now, you're holding this, so the fact is that you're able to do this with any degree of accuracy at all kind of amazes me. But the more to the point is the only reason that you're not able to capture more than a relief is because of stitching. And I don't know if they're going to be providing this soon, but that is just another function of software. As you know, that they've had demos out that have shown full stitched items. But again, this could be using the outside camera and an object. But there are several things on their website that you can go out, you can explore. So here are other things that are created. Now, here's in somebody else's selfie. So yes, a lot of the selfies that are being done lately all seem to look like this. Let's go back to mine. I had much better luck doing static objects, you know, like Ridley here. The other thing that I requested is notice the superfluous stuff, that they should have some editing tools to clip that. Because, you know, you can't just literally throw this out to a 3D printer because that's not going to do you any good. Now you can save these. So you can download them as OBJs or STLs or Collada files and PLLY files. So you can bring them down and edit them if you want. But as mentioned, they don't have a high resolution mode. Okay. And so I think that could trip them up if they don't provide something a little bit more detailed. But again, remember, this is less than $100. And so for, you know, if you've got $300 or $100 or $90 to blow, this would be kind of a fun little product. It does work. It does take some time to practice and get used to it. As mentioned, my attempt to do it here, let's see if this one works. Okay, this one's better. So you ready? Let's see where my camera is. Okay. Well, sort of better. But again, this is because I moved and I disrupted the scan. And you can't, again, you're holding something and you're trying to provide a robotic type feature. And if you're not still when it's going through the scan process, you're going to get disruptions like that. So again, you have to pause, you can't move, and you have to kind of bring it up and down in a very parallel to your face in a very, what do you want to call it, slow, methodical process. And if any of that gets disrupted, this is the kind of stuff you see. But, you know, the detail's not bad. I mean, it's not, it picked up my mustache hairs fairly good. The eyes, you know, there's a little bit, and again, you know, was my camera completely focused? You know, the major point in any of this is that it requires practice and skill. And if you're going to want instant results, not even the structure sensor, even higher price scanners are going to provide that to you. In fact, some of these $10,000, $20,000, you just can't out of the box start scanning. I mean, there is a process that needs to be worked and practiced before you get good quality. I mean, it's the same thing with taking photographs. Yeah, you can clip and capture anything, but to get great photographs, you have to put some effort into it. So I think the same thing here. And the fact is, for $80, you get some reasonable scans. Like you said, to scan to make a face for a 3D model, you can put your face on. That's fairly inexpensive. And I mean, obviously, you have to have some type of smartphone, but even if you don't, it seems to work fine with an iPad or an iPod, or at least the latest generation. So, I mean, I'm not going to rule it out. I think at least my Kickstarter amount, $50, was great. 90, yeah, I don't know as much if that's what you want to do. But with practice, I think you can get much better scans. The sad thing is I own a few structure sensors, so this wouldn't be my choice. And we have another product that's going to be coming out soon, maybe in the next 3 months, from that company from Australia, if you remember. Do you remember their name? That uses that green line scanner?
Yeah, Bevel. No. Eora.
Eora. That's going to be a cool product. And what they do is basically create a device that creates a swivel of the line scanner, all built into one contained cylinder. And it really looks cool using a green line laser, as we talked about, provides even higher definition in the actual scan. And some of their scans are really nice looking. And so I'm really looking forward to that. But now keep in mind, what was that, like $200,
$300? A little spendier for sure.
Yeah. And I don't know if it provides as good quality as for faces. I think you have to remain still for about 20 seconds. So it's about the same. But in regardless, in either case, if you want something to play around with that works, I said it takes practice, but it works. The Bevel 3D is the direction to go. Again, I don't know what the low end of the phones is. Chris is going to have to try this with his 5S. I recommend the iPod Touch 6G is iPhone 6. What do you want to call it? Technology. So, and it works pretty well with that. The iPad mini, as far as the iPad Air 2 or something of that nature, should work fine with it as well. It might be a little more cumbersome because you're using an iPad. But if you don't have an iPhone, it does seem to work with Android. I was not able to get it to work with one of my Android devices, but I haven't put a lot of effort into it. I will report back next week. But I never was able to get the actual laser to turn on. So it went through the visual calibration, but it didn't do the line scanner. So, you know, that's all I can say. It's $89, as mentioned. Here, we'll bring it up.
This is Charlene. This is Charlene's Bevel. This is Captain Pugsley. Charlene likes to capture him in 3D. Captain Pugsley is...
So, again, $89, and you can get it in white or black. And it should be available now. And yeah, Chris is telling me we already saw this. Just summarizing again, Chris. Okay, Chris, why don't you start with our first news item then?
Well, so this one, I wanted to play a little bit on what Josh was covering. Actually, he was covering some great stuff at the LA VR Expo that's happening right now. And but one of the big things right now that's going on is obviously so a lot of people might not know what like 3G, 4G, what that even means. What is 4G? Fourth generation is what it means. And so Intel and a bunch of AT&T and obviously all the carriers, I mean, even since 4G has been out, they've been working on 5G. And now some of the details about 5G are actually starting to be revealed. And there was a keynote that I wanted to share, and I'll put it in the show notes. We're not going to watch the keynote, but the Linux Foundation had the open networking seminar that just happened in Santa Clara. And it happened, was it last week? And one of the keynotes was really, really good. Highly encourage anybody that's in IT or, you know, kind of interested in the backbone of the internet to go and watch her keynote. Sandra Rivera, the VP of Data Center Group and General Manager of the Network Platforms Group at Intel, covered kind of where 5G is going, what it's about, and why we need it, why we need to really expand our bandwidth by, you know, an order of magnitude or several orders of magnitude, is because more data is here. It already is. Autonomous driving. One autonomous vehicle can eat up 4 terabytes per day of data. So we
carriers are gonna love that.
If we have thousands and or millions of vehicles utilizing autonomous driving, which is gonna mean safer roads and just, I think, less traffic, and there's many benefits to autonomous vehicles. But if every car on the road was utilizing that, then we'd definitely be the internet would be screeching to a halt today. So 5G needs to happen, and they're already working on it. They already are making it happen, and they've kind of got some concepts. But they're actually open sourcing it. Intel is actually open sourcing it along with AT&T. So they've got some network planning, kind of the underpinning structure or the scaffold. The underlying architecture is being open sourced. And so you can go find out more about it at the Linux Foundation's YouTube website. They have tons of all of the keynotes are all broadcast now on YouTube, and I'm just kind of, when I find time, kind of picking through, and I love to watch those just to see what's going on with Linux, where the whole thing's headed, because they're kind of the front runners when it comes to developing. You know, they don't have all the technological debt that maybe Microsoft and Apple have. You know, they can just make a new distro of Linux and change whatever they want. You know, there's thousands of distributions of Linux. They call them distros. And really, the majority of the internet, the framework of the internet, is housed on Linux. So knowing what's going on with Linux can kind of tell you what's going to happen in the future. So I like to pay attention to this kind of stuff. And with the VR, like Josh was saying, they have 12K compression. Well, even with a lot of compression, you're still going to require a lot of bandwidth. And 5G is an important part of that, and how it all fits together, you can find out at the Linux Foundation's YouTube.
That sounds great, Chris. Yeah, I can't say that I'm all that excited about that stuff anymore, doing it for so many years. But no, I agree with you, and obviously having to set up and do our live stream, bandwidth is important. And the fact is, as we noticed, Josh was able to provide us on the floor coverage of LAVR.
Yeah.
Or VRLA, sorry.
Through 4G, you know, and before 4G, I mean, he wouldn't have been able to do that.
Yeah. Okay. So let's move on to, is Autodesk getting out of the 3D printer market? Well, sort of. It's kind of a lead-in type. So if you remember, we've talked about it before, Autodesk discontinues the manufacturing of the open source Ember 3D. You remember that one, Chris?
Yeah.
This little unit here, that looked pretty cool. But if you remember, this was pretty expensive, right? Wasn't it like $5,000,
$6,000? No, I don't remember. I just know I love the fact that they were trying. And well, I'm sad to hear that they're not going to make these anymore, but hopefully they'll keep up development in some form.
Well, 3dprint.com, who's the writer, Claire Scott, makes the point that there was a shakeup, a few resignations. You remember we talked about Carl Bass resigning at Autodesk, and this is probably part of that shakeup. The fact is, Autodesk really hasn't been in the market of developing things and manufacturing, so it probably was a good move on their part. Also, it wasn't the cheapest SLA printer, but with all that being said, if you still like the way this looks, all the files and mechanical drawings are available. So if you want to make your own, it's still out there.
Wow.
So it's all still there, and then you can buy the resin from Colorado Photo Polymer Solutions. And then if you come down here, they have, what's the name of it? They have their own little program for it. What's it called? Print Studio. that they're going to stop developing on, but you can still get it because, if you remember, we talked about it, they bought NetFab. And so NetFab has kind of taken its place, but you can still get that as well. It's still available for download. So if you're interested in creating this, it's still out there. The software is still available. But frankly, I think buying what is it now? The Form 2, Form 3, mm-hmm. Form 4, I don't, one of those forms, might be a better deal. If I remember, they're only like $3,500 now.
Yeah, I mean, by the time you get set up with materials and tanks and all that, yeah. And if you want to get a pro plan to have it covered with a warranty and support that you can actually get somebody on the phone or, you know, one of the things that's kind of the new model for support as far as technical support that I'm not a big fan of is they have basically crap support. That's like the base level of anything technical you buy. And then they offer a pro plan, which is basically like, you know, not even great support even then, which is like by email, right? I always like to talk to somebody on the phone. I think talking to somebody on the phone is just, you can get kind of the whatever your technical issue is, you can get it sorted out much more easily. But ever since like the outsourcing whole thing to India and kind of everything going to crap as far as technical support, it's like now they have like the new thing, which is you submit a ticket through email and it's you know, within 24 hours they'll get back to you. So every time you have a correspondence, they ask you a question, then you answer it, then another 24 hours, so you can be down for a week or two before you get anything concrete about what's going on with your machine. And so even with a $500 plan per year, I think it is on the Form Labs machine, I think is $500 a year for the pro plan, but it keeps it covered and it keeps your warranty. So if you have parts, you know, and they do offer some sort of like shipping, if you need to ship your machine back, they'll ship you a new one. So it's, well, I think it's worth it if you're doing a lot of printing and you're, you know,
it's part of your livelihood. So it's right. Not like you can be down. So I think they realize that that's the case for many people who are buying these things. And maybe that, again, might be the reason Autodesk didn't want to get involved with this. You provide a product and you don't provide support for it or don't have the infrastructure. It's probably not a good idea to manufacture and sell them. So who knows? Obviously, they've declined or decided not to stay in that market. But you've got some information on a RepRap Helios?
Yeah. The RepRap Helios, Nicholas Seward, has a new RepRap machine that he's been building on YouTube. He posted a video today. I'll put it into theater mode here so you can see it a little better. And I don't know where the Z stage is. It probably like rides on some sort of rail, but this is an interesting design for a 3D printer here. Looks pretty heavy duty, you know? And I don't really know why, but you know, again, there's a lot of auxiliary technology that's just born out of thinking outside the box. You know, if you build something like this, not only are you, especially if it's a new thing that nobody's done, not only are you guaranteed to learn something, but you're guaranteed to have some sort of thing that you see now that you couldn't see before. So whether it's a 3D printer or not, or a robot arm, or maybe not necessarily a plastic printer, but some sort of other printer, like, you know, I could see this being scaled up and then being like on a truck that a cement truck delivers, and that's how a house is built, you know, or how they use these 3D printer. You know, we've covered the Apis Core and some of these other machines that are for the 3D printing of houses. That are starting to be unveiled now. I think that, you know, technologies like this, where you're thinking outside of the Cartesian bots, the D bots, the Delta bots, you know, new ways, or even that hang printer we saw the other day, it's just new ways to have the mechanics introduced to deposition modeling. So I just thought it was cool. You can check out the RepRap project Helios. which is a cool name. Guy came up with a really good name. And you can check him out. He'll be posting stuff on RepRap, I'm sure. And you can go check it out. I'll have a link in the show notes.
Okay, here we go. So I'm going to move into a couple of 3D rendering technology items, and I'll play this video. You know, I've talked about the Amazon Lumberyard sometime, actually looked at it at GDC, and thought it was pretty cool. But, you know, I thought maybe they just kind of bought the technology, really weren't going to go anywhere with it, but that is not true at all. They actually have this great article, but I'll play the video first. And the reason, is there audio behind this?
Wow. There's no audio, but I think you can leave the audio off. It's fine.
Yeah, I don't think there is any.
Oh, it's showing a difference.
Right. And what it is they're showing a new type of temporal anti-aliasing, and you're seeing the difference between the two there. And I'm going to come back and slide in so you can see.
So this is the new?
Yes.
So less artifacts. So
let me pause it and then go back a little bit.
Oops. Wow. It just blows me away. Like this, like just how cinematic they can make it look. I mean, this is just amazing how real that looks.
But the important thing to look at here, and I don't know if this is, you may not or may not be able to see it at 720p, is the edges. And this is the big problem with real-time engine is providing great aliasing. And this researcher that now works for Amazon Lumberyard, or actually the on the product Lumberyard, talks about how they're fighting it. And I'll go ahead and bring that up here. Where's my screen? Ooh. There we go. So here's a great article. It'll be in the show notes as well. And this is the scene that they created called the Bistro. But he talks about why it's important. And there's some these nice charts here. And we made huge strides. And it talks about the number of polygons. But why do we care so much about pixel quality? And here it talks about that. But let's get down to some of the illusions. We've all seen this, and this is kind of cool. What happens when your certain aliasing exceeds your sample rate, the wheel starts turning backwards. Here we go. See how it's starting to rotate backwards now? Because you're now exceeding the sampling rate, and that's one of the illusions. But so he now talks about different anti-aliasing techniques, super sampling, MSAA, FXAA, and then temporal, which is the one that seems to be the default in Unreal, but I don't like it because it does create this ghosting and transparency effect, especially in VR, especially on a mobile phone, a mobile device. But now they've come up with this new, this is the basic temporal AA theory behind it, kind of shows you, meaning temporal, it actually provides the anti-aliasing over time versus static. And then here's where they use temporal AA variance clipping. And the whole purpose of all that is to avoid this ghosting and the softening of the frame, because it'll clip that out and it actually provides a much more detailed edge. So, and then here it talks about specular aliasing, which is important for glass objects. And then obviously here we have a little video of that. Again, you can see the aliasing on the left and the right. See the flickering in the bottles that disappears on the left?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can definitely notice a difference. Yeah, with that. Okay. Yeah, I see the flickering over here now. Wow. Who figures all this out?
Geniuses.
Yeah, people are just really, really smart. They just keep going with it. It's just never ending.
Good job, guys. Well, but most important is that this is happening on Amazon Lumberyard, which, if you remember, we talked about it. I started out with just the Crytek engine, which in itself, remember the old jokes about, yeah, but can it run on the Cry engine? depending on your PC because you needed a beefy machine. Well, they bought, I don't know, at that particular point, just whatever the engine was at that point in time. And now they're putting a lot of time and effort in order to create better improvements as we're seeing here. The other strength behind the Lumberyard, which I haven't started playing with yet, is be able to use all the tools from the Amazon AWS tool set. So this should be more robust for a multi-user system. And there's already companies jumping ship with other engines to go with them specifically for that reason. So, you know, this might be the resurgence of the MMO. Who knows? I don't know. In VR. But so I thought that was cool, but then I'm going to jump right into my next little video because I don't want to leave Unreal out of the loop. This one's cool because this actually comes with a tutorial that I think is
that's excellent. Render. So
that's not only render, that's real-time rendering.
What?
Yeah, pretty stunning, huh? And the reason that they're showing this is that they did this huge tutorial showing you what it would take to do this. So you can do it, Chris. So it's not just like...
Well, yeah, I made this whole thing. I totally coded it from scratch, modeled that guy, you know, textured it. I did the whole thing, so...
So as you can see, it's
did it stunning. In my sleep, practically. Wow, that's amazing.
But let's go ahead and move into that. So like I said, it's a full tutorial. And that was the video showing it being done. And it goes through and talks about, let's see, did I miss it? So let's click on the accompanying documentation. But this tells you how to actually do it. Now, they say that the model itself is available, but I have not seen it yet. So I don't know if it's on GitHub. But so essentially, here's that video we just watched, and then it tells you step by step how to create this yourself. So it talks about the skin shader textures, what you need, and what their purpose is. So if you're not familiar with this, it would be a good place to start. And then it gets into the hair shading, and they spend a lot of time here because they talk about the important things in order to create realistic hair. Because as you or may not know, this is what hair really looks like. So it's just a bunch of planes put together, and then you use textures, many textures, in order to create the look, and then talk about depth information. And then they also talk about creating shaders. And one of the things that they use is tangent shading in order to provide a interesting, what do you want to call it? View of the hair itself on how light affects it. And then they get into actual eyes and a great detailed tutorial on creating eyes and what you need to look at. And it talks about the different parts of the eyes, refraction in the eye, and then actually creating the eye shader. And again, if this is a model that's going to be available, this all will be available for you to look at, pull apart, and take what you need in order to create realistic humans. Now, what I see happening is this being used in VR to create virtual characters that come to life. And, you know, I've already seen some examples of that, and it's pretty stunning to walk around a character that looks very lifelike. Now, keep in mind that this particular character didn't have any animation, but imagine a character that turns its head to follow you and then asks you questions using like Siri or something like that and responds in a lifelike voice. I mean, this is where we're coming to, the virtual assistant that you can literally work with. Yeah, as my wife says, oh, your new wife's coming soon. She speaks only when you want her to, interacts with you only when you want her to. Hi, honey. She sometimes watches this. So I thought this was pretty cool. And like I said, supposedly they're coming out with a test model.
I love the texture. It looks like a sumo guy.
Yeah. Well, that's because they unwrap it. But the different version.
I know.
I've been working on it. Actually, I'm going to be bringing that up in my rummaging in the tech closet here shortly. Next week, I'll actually be talking about shaders. But shaders are really cool, and that's what gives you the oomph and life to your projects. And so this is obviously something great to look at if you're creating virtual human or lifelike characters that require hair. So hats off to Unreal, not keeping all their technology close to their chest and releasing demos. And they have great demos of a lot of things that you can work with. And I have learned a lot from them. So keep that in mind. So yeah, I think that, what do you got coming up in our architectural area? Are we there? Oh, that was the rep up Helios and you did the key jet. Okay, so I'm gonna move on to my next item while we're here. So as we've already talked about, I think, as I call it, VAMR, V-A-M-R, virtual augmented and mixed reality, is going to make a huge difference in manufacturing and design because it allows you to see your components either by themselves in virtual or, as in this case with the HoloLens, in a mixed reality situation where you can see how it's going to actually play up on a device, let's say, I guess this is some type of impeller play, blade or something, how it would fit without actually creating it. However, as mentioned, they want to create standards. Standards are always good because, you know, you don't want your parts not fitting correctly. So they're talking about getting together and creating a series of standards and how augmented reality works. Here's a tablet being used to show a, it looks like a canister being put on a cat, and then obviously the glasses here. So there's going to be a lot of work in this area, and as mentioned, standards are great. Here's another tablet device that actually works with a 3D printer that shows you information about your 3D printer while it's printing. I don't know, kind of neat. So there you go. You can try that one out, Chris. So yeah, lots of fun things coming up, and see where we're at now. I guess I've got the next one too. I'll just keep working. So I thought this was kind of cool. And actually, I think I can play some audio with this, maybe. Let me know if you hear anything. Here we go. Okay, you ready, Chris?
I'm ready.
We have a number of cat mummies in the collection, and this was a nice
Can
one.
Can you hear that?
Basically, what we're doing is items in the university collection to make more use of them for teaching. So using photogrammetry and other techniques, we're able to create virtual versions of objects, which otherwise just you can't handle for, you know, other than a specialist coming in and looking at them. We're really looking at things that would be relevant to students of medicine and maybe archaeology as well. But also thinking some of the objects in the museum that are rather intriguing and attractive that would get people's attention. You are able to get that ability to look very closely. So it's not just a representation of the object, it's being able to look at the detail and really understand it. That's been really important. The question, of course, always is what's inside it? Is it actually a cat mummy or not? There are cases where what's inside is not what you'd expect. We did actually have a crocodile mummy, and all that was in it was the crocodile's head. There was no body. So we wanted to know. So we were able to create this representation of it, so we've got a real sense of the outside. And then also we CAT scanned it, and it's a bad pun, but never mind. And we discovered inside that the real cat is a tiny wee kitten, much, much smaller than the bandages. So presumably what went on was that actually at a temple, they were selling mummified cats for people to give as a gift to the temple. And you'd make more money out of selling a large cat than a little one. So they bulked it out. I think it does give a bit of an insight into what was going on in the temple of, you know, daily life and how they were making offerings to the gods in Egypt.
Photogrammetry is a technique for building 3D models from photographs. So basically it consists in taking a lot of photographs around an object and then using a clever piece of software to stitch them all together and build a 3D model. And the result is very good. The textures are very realistic. So anyone can rotate the model, zoom into the object, and explore the texture and the shape of the 3D model at any device.
On the one hand, we're thinking of the students in University of Aberdeen and their chance to really make use of the collections. I mean, it's a wonderful privilege being a student in Aberdeen when you've got the collection and we need to make more use of it. The other thing, of course, is we're able to web mount them. So they're going to be available to anybody who wants to see these things. And there are a number of international projects looking at things like cat mummies, so we're contributing to international scholarship as well as our own teaching.
Well, I thought that was pretty cool for a variety of reasons. Let me turn down the mix on that. So the thing, as I titled it, is maybe this is the first evidence of scamming in the ancient land of Egypt. Hey, I got this cat mummy for you, but it may only have a rat inside it, you know. But you know, it's not like you'd open it up. But with the CT scanning, we're able to actually look inside in three dimensions and see what's inside these without actually having to open them up or damage them, which I think is super cool. And as you mentioned, using photogrammetry for the external, you can have some pretty interesting models. Now imagine looking at that in VR, where you have like a slider that could show the internals and you slide it up and down with your hand. I don't know, some opportunities there. So, you know, obviously a lot of things that we can explore using this technology, but I thought that was kind of a cool item from a scanning perspective and 3D in medicine. Just imagine you can go in, get a scan of your body and be able to show it to your friends. Just like the Bevel 3D, it'll be the Cat 3D. You know, just a little unit you plug into your wall and scan yourself. I'm ranting. All right, so Chris, you've got something about a Mantis Vision F6 that's like super expensive.
It's a $15,000 scanner. So this is Mantis Vision's F6. It isn't your average handheld scanner. This comes from spar3d.com. And apparently Mantis Vision announced a new best of breed handheld 3D scanner. It's basically designed to do low noise, 640,000 points per second. And it'll do says less than 0.5 millimeters at a meter's range. And the accuracy is 0.1 to 0.2% of the scanning distance. And it's a little handheld thing, and it's really optimized for 0.5 meters to 4.5 meters away from the object. And it's a USB 2 thing, and they have a little demo video here, but it'll be coming May 31st at a price of $15,000. And here you can actually see live content creation. So here's going to show a little high quality, high accuracy scanner.
Well, an important point, and I don't know if you mentioned this, is the fact is these characters are moving.
Yep. And that's another part of it.
So not only can you capture 3D objects, but you can capture them over time and like they're showing there. So this would be very similar to a technique that would be used in that video we saw earlier about the solitary confinement.
So it'll actually capture RGB video at 8 frames per second. So yeah, that's a also super important part of this scanner. So for 15,000, if you're I'm very interested to see what this thing's capable of and where they're going to go next with it.
And we'll see one from Chris soon.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so because we had Josh on earlier with his VRLA, we're going to call it man on the floor
second. Yeah.
I think we're going to kind of skip the VR corner in the round room today.
What sure. Yeah, that sounds perfect. You know,
some of the things that we'll just, because they're not really super eventful other than Google's really talking up web VR, and it'll be in the show notes about web VR experiments. So if you're interested in something like that, go out there and look at it. Web VR is going to be kind of cool. I've been playing with it. The sad thing, the Chrome browser, as it stands right now, at least for the desktop, does not support it. Ironically, if you're using Windows, Windows Edge does. So I've been able to show things using the Windows Edge browser that I cannot in Chrome. But I think it needs to be the Creative Edition or one of the inside previews for that to work. So web VR, we'll talk more about all the other thing. And I think I'll devote my section next week to audio in VR. VR or audio in VR is very important because you can move your head around. And there's a company called, I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, Dysonics, that I'm going to spend some time playing with. They have a plugin that you can use. And I hear some clicking on your end, Chris. some, maybe somebody else is with, I don't know. Oh, well. But Dysonics makes a plugin that can be used with Audition from Adobe, as well as any other DAW that you may be familiar with. And it allows you to move objects in the 3D spherical space. So if you had, for instance, what I'm going to use it for is I have a five-channel recording device, portable, and I'd like to record those channels and then put them in their proper location in space, along with a 360 camera so that I can be able to capture, let's say, the outdoors as well as all the ambient sounds, like birds and that. So as you turn your head, if there's like a bird behind you, you'd actually be able to hear it. So that's my objective. They do make special microphones with a multiple array in a spherical that can be used as well. I think they sell one, but they're normally pretty expensive. So I'm going to see what I can do with this five-channel recording device, which is less expensive. So I'll talk about that next week. So that's about it. You've got Rick and Morty VR games to talk about. So maybe we can hold off because I think that's not available till next week anyways, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So Chris, you have something cool that you want to talk about in your print whisper. So why don't you go first, and then I'll end it with my little part two of my tutorial on VR. What is it that I'm doing? Oh, VR home remodeling. Okay. Go ahead, Chris.
Okay. Well, today I want to talk about keeping an open door and how to help your fellow man or woman. So there's so many good ideas out there, and they're squandered all the time due to a lack of follow through or implementation. You probably have pet projects in your life that have been squandered that same way. And they're easy ideas that solve problems that everybody has. And pretty much every person I know has great ideas pumping through them all the time. I mean, everybody I talk to, nephews, uncles, you know, parents, brothers, friends, doesn't matter. They're all having good ideas. And some are practical, others aren't, and that's okay. Some are simple personalized solutions, while others are viable products that have the ability to generate passive income. So when it comes to a family member, a friend, student, or neighbor, you have the ability to help realize amazing things with your 3D printer. Not just your own ideas, but others. And a lot of times those things are hung up due to financial constraints, and a big one is laziness, obviously. But most people don't have the means to design and develop things on the computer and then print them or prototype them or make them real tangible objects. And so one of my all-time favorite books is The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Highly recommend this one. This has been one that you've probably seen since you were a kid, or, you know, if you're my age, you were a kid when it came out. But it's been highly recommended, been in kind of the self-help business circles. And it explains the idea behind interdependence, the dependence of two or more people or things on each other. You can't have interdependence without independence. And you can't have interdependence with dependence. You're not necessarily tied or locked to people. It's interdependence. It's a different concept. And there's more behind this life-changing philosophy in the book. And I can't possibly cover the whole chapter on interdependence here in the time we have. So check out the book on Amazon and Audible to find out more. But one thing is that what I've learned from that is to have an open door here. So I've been opening up every other Friday or so after this podcast and inviting family members, friends, for small projects around here, whatever. I'm calling them inventor days. And it really helps not only with them, it not only helps them, but it helps me build my skills, and it really fosters and nurtures the relationships I have. I mean, we have some really great time together, and they get to understand what I do, how I do it. And so I put these days in my calendar now, and I invite, it's like by invitation, And I kind of, you know, if somebody, I tell people, hey, I'm telling my family and my friends, people I'm close with, hey, I, you know, if you have ideas, let me know about them, and we can come in and you can sit down on a Friday, and you know, it's not about monetary compensation or anything. So they get to learn kind of the process and how it all flows together. And I get to learn how to do stuff better and how to interact with people better, and kind of, you know, kind of my most successful part of my business now is this one-on-one CAD approach. So I invite inventors and creators of all sorts that want to draw things. They don't know how to draw it on 3D, but they have napkin sketches in 2D or even thorough design sketches, and they bring them over. And that's how I work now, is we meet right here and I draw it. We do one-on-one meetings, or sometimes I meet with a team. And so it actually helps me get better at that. It helps me tailor my craft, because I'm actually working with my family and friends who are also open to, like, you know, they're a lot more open about criticisms or critiques, you know, when we're working together. So I learn a lot. And I also feel like a writer that gets to tell a story that's not 100% my own, but I get to kind of have my own spin on it. And it's just a really fun time. And so I have no expectation of reward other than the opportunity to give back to somebody that I care about. And trust me when I say it pays back 1,000-fold. So I really encourage anyone to try this and see how it affects you. And it doesn't have to be a permanent thing, but highly, if you have a 3D printer and 3D CAD experience, I highly encourage you to offer up even just a few hours and sit down with a family or a close friend and help bring something that they have an idea to life.
I think that's an excellent idea. I'm going to start today with Ricky.
Awesome.
He's got some ideas and he's just been going.
Good. Yeah. Yeah, you know, and everybody has them. I mean, it's just unbelievable how many ideas, you know, we'll be hiking and every single friend that I have will tell me some idea that's like, dude, that's a great idea. That's just an amazing idea. And my partner, she has ideas constantly about things that are like little problems she has, you know, or even just a little thing around the house. It doesn't have to be a commercial thing. It could be a private problem that it solves, like a little thing that they need done. And, you know, it's just a really good practice to do, you know, to do it without compensation, or do it without the expectation of having compensation, like monetary. And obviously, like, cost of materials, that's one thing. So, like, you know, they'll offer, people will, you know, whatever I owe you, you tell me what I owe you. And it's like, no, you don't owe me anything. If you want to buy material, you can, you know, you can buy a spool of material, and, you know, because usually the material is pretty cheap nowadays, especially for, like, some of my favorite materials, like engine, that I'll keep plugging over and over. Love that engine stuff. Not super durable, but for prototypes, it's amazing stuff. I mean, you get a really nice surface finish out of it.
And if we had somebody who was on the ball here on the production side, they would have a little screen flash. Engine, go here.
It's great stuff, man. That stuff is amazing how good it prints. So,
well, thank you, Chris. And, you know, maybe you can add a little anecdote. Hey, had such and such come in, and this is how we solved this problem. Really glad to hear that from you.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we're making all kinds of fun stuff. And, yeah, I mean, a lot of times they're just little projects that are like a little, you know, a little Arduino project, or a little, you know, I've been working on camera slider projects and all kinds of really fun ones. And, yeah, I'll definitely share some maybe next week or the week after.
I'd love to see some of the stuff that you hold so close to your chest. Okay, well, thank you, Chris. So I'm going to take over right now and talk about my VR home remodeling. And I don't know, my mic is pretty good. And plus, I'm like behind two doors back in my tech closet. And you may not hear the pounding and beating, but they're finally putting in that wood paneling floor that you may have seen in previous renders that I put out. But I've been walking on that virtual wood floor for weeks now. And what's funny is that it really kind of looks like the same wood. So it's kind of odd. But that's let's see how we got there. So essentially, I'm going to bring up, last night we covered SketchUp, so we're going to go back to SketchUp. So let me bring up the screen that's behind me. And, oops, bang my mic again like I did the last time. All right, can you hear me okay, Chris?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm turning to my little laptop this is on, and as you can see behind me, this is the bathroom that I was working on. And I just realized that the mouse that I'm working with doesn't allow me to rotate. Which is stuck. For whatever reason, this particular mouse does not allow me to use the set of them. Oh well, I won't need to use it. I can use one of these anyways. There we go. Okay, so first thing I'm going to do is take off the top. So I'll hide it. Actually, sorry about that. Unhide it. And we'll go down to the outliner. If you remember, I showed you this last time. And one of the things that I did last week was go through and make sure that you identify the names for everything that you are using. So I've done that here, and I've also created different selections. So one of them is the roof. So now I should be able to go through. Why didn't it unhide? So now I should be able to go through and just hide the roof because it's a selection. And it's calling me a liar already. Nothing works. Okay, so I'll get down into it. So essentially, I've put a little more work into it, put some lights in. And if you remember, the idea is, can we put a bathtub in it? And I have it over here. But I've created multiple selections. So for instance, the bathtub is its own selection, and I'll show you by hiding it. So notice it's gone now. So the reason I've created these different selections, and let's see, I should be able to unhide it from here. For instance, the vanity counter above it will need to be removed, is because I want to bring these in Unreal as separate pieces. Now, if you just bring in the whole thing into Unreal and you don't allow Unreal to combine it, then you have all these pieces, and literally you have to drag all those pieces in one at a time because it does not keep the relative positioning. It all puts them back at a 0 point, unless they're combined. So I created individual pieces, and I'm going to go through that process of right now. In fact, save some time. So let's go ahead and unhide this. So essentially, all I need to do is select whatever I want to export. And then so I can go over to our export. And now if you've got the free version, the only thing that you can do in the free version, and I have a 30-day version here, is the Collada file. With the pro version, if you're willing to spend $800, you can go and provide multiple formats, including FBX, which is the favorite for Unreal. So if you want to spend $800, go ahead. I think there's a free version, but I found that the free version doesn't give you much control. But if you've got $800, you want to buy SketchUp, go for it. You have lots of different other options in it. But we're going to stick with the free, and then I call this the main bathroom. I will go out to my, I already have a link for it on my server. And as you can see, I've already created them, so I'm not going to recreate it. I have one called bathroom bathtub, bathroom main mesh, main bathroom roof, and then the vanity counter. And so now that I've exported all those, I'll just cancel. I can close this and bring up, Blender. And again, Blender is a free tool. Let's hope the right one comes up. I didn't uninstall the previous version. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is the latest version. So get rid of our little cube in the middle. And then come over here and then do an import. And you do a Collada. Now I've already bookmarked, and you can set up bookmarks for all your network links, which don't show up immediately. So I highly recommend that you have bookmarks for any place that you're working with, because it really expedites the process. And then we'll bring in that main mesh DAA or Collada file. So we'll import it. And there you go. And again, because my stupid mouse isn't working correctly, I can't do much with it. But I've already put all the effort in. But essentially, you really don't have to do anything else at this point. But if you're used to or you're familiar with Blender, you can do further grouping. You could also create ambient occlusion baking, which I'm going to show a little bit next week. I'm not going to talk about it now. But basically, all you have to do is bring it in here and use it as an exporter. I would suggest removing any cameras. But there's a way to isolate cameras later on, and we can do that now. So you go to the export, but make sure you select what you want. And there's a couple ways. The easiest way is just hit the A key, which then selects everything. And then go to export, and then find FBX. And as mentioned, I've already done this ahead of time. But the thing down here, if you can see them in the bottom left-hand corner, is a selection of what you want to send along. So normally, I only select empty, mesh, and other. I do not bring in the camera or the lamps, or the amateur or armature if you have an animated character. We don't, we have a static model. And then everything else, you pretty much leave the defaults, go to the FBX 7.4 binary, and that's it. And then you just save it. Just do an export, put in your name, whatever the path is, and then you're good to go. So now we can close out this because I've already done it. And then we're going to bring up Unreal, which I brought up earlier, and bring up the template to do virtual reality. And so when you bring it up, they're actually, this is what comes up, and this won't help you. This gives you the ability to select pretty much instructions. You have to then go to the proper levels. So we're going to open up our virtual reality map for motion controllers and let that import. Okay. So there you go. So it already has a camera and everything built in, as well as the controllers. So all the work has been done for you. So this makes it super easy. Then what I would do, and I'm not going to worry about right now, is you'd clean up all these blocks because you don't need these. And then you just drop in your items. So you go down to this import feature here. And then we go, and since I already have a link to the master bedroom, we then find our FBX for the, let's go with the main bathroom main. Okay, and then hit open. And then a selection screen is going to come up. And here's the important thing. So see this FBX import. Now I just loaded this up. So all my settings here are going to be whatever the defaults are. So we're going to leave pretty much everything selected. I found that the scaling seems to work about right. So you don't have to change your scaling. We want to automatically generate collisions, but I found that the collisions create some weird issues. Remember when I had to like move my mouse a bunch of times in that video because I was like in the middle of a collision? So what I would do, well, maybe you weren't on that episode, but essentially when I was inside, I did a little video of, you were there, of me actually inside the VR room, and I was using the controller, but because I had collisions, I couldn't really move like you can like teleport. Remember, it was like teleporting in little baby steps?
And, vaguely.
So I would suggest not bringing in them and building them manually so that you can teleport within your space. And you do that by creating collision holes around your object, not the object itself. So the other thing is pretty much leave everything else the same, except we want to select combined meshes. Believe me, you want to do this. You can play with it. You don't want 100 separate meshes. Let it combine it into one object. What else do we want to look at? We want to import materials and textures, so all that will go. And what that does with the materials is it basically generates your materials. And the way Unreal works is that it brings in textures, and then you have to create materials for each. So this just saves a step. Now, everything that's being done now could be done manually as well. You don't have to bring any, and then you can import your textures as you need them and then assign them. But this will do a pretty good job of doing it right now. So basically I have all that done and then I just hit import all. However, let me look at one other thing because this is going to be important. Let me see where it's at. I always miss this. Okay, generate light maps. For it to create shadows, it needs to create a proper light map to create that. That's part of the baking process. And I have found that this has been my hang up in previous models. If I had smaller models, and this may not be an issue, with my larger home, the light maps weren't large enough. So even though I had enabled it, it never created it. And what it does, it creates another set of UV maps for the light map. And it never created it. And I kept pulling my hair out. Why are my shadows so bad after baking? So that's what I figured out. All right, so I'm going to import all. So what will happen is down here, I will have, and they'll just open up in the folder. I would suggest making a new folder for your assets instead of just dropping them in and cluttering things up. So organize them. But for here, it'll take a little bit of time. It normally, for whatever reason, hangs on 75% and then boom. So as you can see, it talks about I had no smoothing groups, which is true. SketchUp doesn't say smooth. And then it talks about degenerate tangent base results in incorrect shading. That hasn't been a huge issue, but I'm not going to focus on that at this point. So notice it brought in the model here, as well as all the materials and, all the textures, which are then created materials of them. You see them there? And your materials are the little globes. And then the texture is right next to it. And I'll talk about that more next week, but I'll drop it in. Can you see it there? And I just dropped it in on my camera. So well, that might be fun. So can you see it?
Chris? Yeah.
There you go. Now this is just using some simple textures. I haven't added specular. I haven't added any bump or there's something else. I can't even name it. Normal maps to it. Some of the other features like reflections, I haven't added, which are pretty cool because you can create reflection balls. But we're going to talk about that more next week when we create Peter's here. But there you go. Can you see it?
Yeah.
All right. So my camera should be in there somewhere. Let me find my VR pod. Oh, there you go. You can see a little screen. So I'm going to bring it inside. So when we actually end, there you go. And I'm going to rotate the camera. Okay, so we'll do it like that. So now, if things go right, I should be able to, that says lighting. So I'm going to go ahead and build lighting. And this may or may not work, depending on if the light map by UV was created. And then, so let's go ahead and rebuild. And this can take a little bit of time, depending on the performance of your machine. So it's, as you can see there, it has a new feature called streaming textures, and then it uses something called the swarm agent. So if you've got several machines, you can actually farm this out to multiple machines to do your mapping. I have not done that yet, but I know that some have, and that will reduce the time.
A render farm type situation.
Yep. And what it does is it does the light baking that we're going to see here, and it shows that everything's working except... it's now creating the lighting on the bottom right-hand corner. It's at 33%. Depending on the complexity of your model, this could take a long time. Okay, so we should be able to close that. And now we're building lighting. Yeah, we're at 0%. So cross your fingers that it's not too complex and our UV1 was created, which will create our shadows. Now, right now, what we have is, let's see, we may have a dynamic light in there, but it's creating the static lighting. And this is lighting that doesn't change. So if you have a fixed light, all right, so it's going to, now it's also recompiling, yeah. So notice the funkiness in the mapping there, like a zebra. Can you see that, Chris? Chris, you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So see how the texture textures are funky.
Yeah.
Okay, so the reason for that is that it did not ever create the UV1. So even though it's recompiling texture, the actual light map is all wrong because it's using the UV map for the whole project. And the reason for it is these UV maps for the objects in here are all stacked on each other, so they overlap. So what we need to do, and I found after playing with it, the way to get around that is you bring in the model, which will look okay. Let's see. And then we have to go over to UVs. Notice how we don't have a UV one. It's just one channel, UV channel zero. So in order to create UV channel one, we have to go into our settings here and just push up our UV. Let's see, did I go too far? It's down. Okay, see where it says the light map resolution is 64? This is too small. So I think 128 worked. So now I should be able to go back. Now that I've changed that, where'd it go? I guess if I expanded the screen, it would give me more room. Okay. Okay, so there should be an option now to apply changes. Well, can't seem to find it. Well, now it's hung up. Well, I'm not going to keep any more time, but essentially what should happen now, I don't know why I'm hung up. Well, that's good. So essentially what should happen now is it will develop, once I increase the size of that light map, it will actually generate UV1. But there is something that says enable or apply changes. There we go. Okay, see the apply changes there?
Mm-hmm.
That highlights, you can apply it and then it will generate the UV map. For whatever reason, I've lost control.
Seems like it froze up.
Yep.
Oh, there's a auto saving out of date packages.
Well, the other Oh, well. Okay, so back. Well, that's the problem when you're using a laptop that's 3 years old.
It's amazing, though, that this even, you know, you're broadcasting at the same time.
Well, this is actually a different, this is a separate machine.
Oh, got it.
So I'm, we would probably be dead in the water if I did that. Okay, so I probably have forgotten a step, dummy me. But essentially, you should have a feature that says apply changes once this is changed. Unless I've forgotten something. But the other thing I can go through real quick is that if you notice, there is a list of materials here. They're called material slots, and each of these represent a texture.
Yeah.
And down here.
And you can assign those textures to.
To a material or an element slot. And then down here allows you to identify where this texture, and for whatever reason, it's sluggish. But if you look over here, you can actually isolate it to show each piece there. So it actually shows the plane. Can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
So highlight it, and then we can actually look at the different planes. And then I can turn off this UV here so we don't have to show that anymore. Yeah. So as you notice, I get a message saying my frame rate is low. Okay. So this way you can go through and figure out which of your materials is associated with what meshes, and then you can either change them after the point. The other thing is, and I'll jump back to the other screen, is each of these materials can be double-clicked on to show the shader. And notice, it's pretty basic. It basically provides or applies the texture to a base color. But notice you can select metallic, specular, roughness, which is reflections, and emissive color, and then normals. So there's a lot of things you can apply to this. Plus, each of these can be combined with other things. So you can create these very intricate, algorithms on creating a shader for a particular item. If you need something that's translucent, notice how some of these items are grayed. You'd have to come over here and determine. Let's see. This. And for instance, it's a blend mode of opaque. Drop that down to translucent. Notice it changes, but then we lose some of our other features for opaque. And then you can change your opacity. And again, that can be controlled through an algorithm. And this is how I use to create glass. And this is how Unreal also creates glass as well. And then you can also put in an emissive so it can glow a little bit. So yeah, it's pretty cool. And then obviously you can also apply ambient occlusion, which could be the texture, or you can bake that in within the engine itself. So close that, and then you can have, notice if you modify it, you have to save it, otherwise it doesn't actually work within your engine, or you can hit apply. So I'm not going to save it, and then we can come back to this. So I apologize for it's not working, but the point to keep in mind is your mesh model needs to have a UV channel 1. And if it's too complex, that won't be created. So then you're going to have to play around with the light map size. And I've been able to bump it from 64 to 128, and that worked. But you may find that that may not be large enough to get really good shadowing. So you need to maybe bump that up. Keep in mind, if you increase it, it takes longer to bake. More detail or more rendering time. So next week I will make sure that I go through and figure out why it's not working now, and we'll spend our time here. The other thing I'm going to do is show you how to actually add more nuances to the textures that you bring in. and also a tool to create normal maps as well as specular and things like that automatically in Photoshop. It's a inexpensive tool. I think it's like $60 that you can use Photoshop with. So if you have a subscription to Photoshop, and it will use a 2D image. So if you have a texture, it will create the information needed to give it, you know, kind of grit. And then we'll play around with 3D paint a little bit as well, very quickly to show how to create, what do they call them now? I've forgotten the name for it. Environmental textures, which give it that real grittiness, and which can also be imported into Unreal. So not that you need it in a remodel, unless, you know, like you're remodeling an old building somewhere that's falling apart, but it's something to look at. So the goal is to do shaders, and then the final week, which will be 2 weeks from now, we're going to be doing that. We talked with Josh, the mixed reality video functionality, where I'll actually be inside the remodel, and then I'll take you outside, because by that time we'll have the new flooring in, the fireplace, and then you'll see my VR version, and then you'll see the real version. So that should be an interesting comparison. So far, it has actually paid for itself with the structure sensor, which is what we did last week, because I found some measurement issues with the fireplace that we're able to rectify prior to it actually being assembled. Okay.
Awesome.
That's about it on my end, Chris. With that, I think we should thank all.
Yeah, thank you, Josh, for joining us this morning. That was awesome. A little tour of LA VR and PBS.org, Forbes, Emblematic, YouTube, Unreal Engine, Live Sciences, Spar3D, Road to VR, as usual. Thank you to all of our listeners, and we will see you next week on All Things 3D.
Bye.